Hi, welcome to Horror Rewind. This is Kelly Florence.
And I'm Meg Hoftal.
And today we're talking about the Fear Street Trilogy.
Woohoo!
Now, Meg, I need to know your history with this and R.L. Stine, because here's my confession. And I saw the editor of Fangoria say this the other day. He was too old to have read the Goosebumps books and stuff. And so he, although he appreciates R.L. Stine, he missed the boat on that. I did too. I was, I think I was too old to read Goosebumps. I mean, no one's, yeah. Too old, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, like it was just not in your.
I skipped straight to Stephen King.
Yeah. Well, sorry, I'm not as cool as you.
No, I'm just old. Now, you read, did you read Fear Street? Did you read Goosebumps?
So I started to read Goosebumps when I was about. Like 9 or 10, I remember reading some, and then I got into Fear Street because Goosebumps was just not hardcore enough for me. So it was so fun at the very beginning and the very first 1994 movie when he's got the first book, and I had that one, and like the cover, just like, what is it about those sort of sensory those images from your childhood, and you haven't seen it since? I mean, I haven't seen those Fear Street covers since I was 12, you know. And so it kind of like brought it back to me, and I started to remember things, because, you know, I think a lot of that I kind of just locked away in my mind and I didn't really think about, but this kind of made me excited about Fear Street again. And then of course everybody now wants Fear Street books, so I went to thriftbooks.com to see if they had any, and they were all sold out, like every single one. So like all the, you know, original covers and stuff. So that's like the gold if you could find one right now.
I bet. That's amazing. I'm sure they'll be reprinting.
Oh yeah.
This 1994 one, I absolutely love. I love the mall vibes. I love that she worked, the girl in the beginning works at a B. Dalton.
Oh yes.
Now I know that you grew up all over the place, but you spent much of your childhood in Canada. Was it like the typical mall vibe, like in this movie? Like, 'cause this felt my 90s mall vibe experience.
Oh yeah. No, the mall was just like, I think for most Americans in the 90s, the mall was like where it was at. That's where you spent your time. That's where everybody was. And certainly when I moved to Minnesota, like that was my number one thing, was like, what's the mall going to be like? You know, the important things in life. And you always thought you were going to like meet the love of your life there. At least I did.
I know.
I would like, you know, hang around like the arcade just in case some cute boy wanted to notice me around there.
No, it was exactly that. It's like, what boys are we going to see at the mall? And sometimes you would see boys from your school or other schools. Mm-hmm. Like, holy crap, it was the biggest deal.
Yeah.
I know we've talked about this before, like when we've talked about Dawn of the Dead, but like my friend and I would just go around and be like, okay, if we lived here, this would become this. This would be my bedroom. Yep. Like, why did you want to live at the mall?
I know, right? I don't know. It was just too cool. And like, I know, like food court food was the best food, and that's where you'd see the boys, and they'd be sitting like on the other side, and you'd have to be very like, you'd have to really plan out where you're going to sit and everything. But no, when they showed, what's her name? Maya Hawke in the B. Dalton bookstore, I was just so happy. It just brought back that 90s feel. And it was nice to have some 90s nostalgia, because obviously 80s nostalgia is really big, but I like the 90s. That's fun.
I loved it too. And I know some people's complaint about this one. It didn't bother me, but they were saying there were too many needle drops, too much good music. And you know what? Bring it on. It didn't bother me.
That didn't bother me either. I thought the soundtrack was great. I think that I saw another complaint. A lot of people are complaining, and that's fine. Everybody can feel how they want to feel. I personally really enjoyed all three movies. And I mean, obviously, and then there's that sort of natural inclination to like rank them too, which is fine. Everybody, you do you. But one complaint I saw is that the characters were really unlikable in this movie. And I didn't feel that way. I mean, I felt like, I guess there were some maybe tropes as far as like some of the characters, but I don't know. I kind of like how complicated the lesbian couple was, and Josh, the brother. I liked him. And even like the side characters, like the girl that Josh was crushing on, like she could be a kind of a bitch, I guess, so to speak. But like, so like, I don't think that means that I don't want to watch her. So I don't know. I like the characters.
Yeah. And I don't think that people need to be perfect. And I don't think they necessarily need to be likable. I think it makes for a more realistic and interesting story.
Yeah. I don't know. I was fine with it. I mean, I thought it was fun. I thought they were fun. And it's funny how, like, when someone is cast in a role, how it kind of, like, gets into your mind. What I mean is that the actress from Ozark is in the second movie as Ruby's mother, and she's in the third movie as the witch, the creepy witch in the cabin. And what kind of struck me was she's in the first movie for like like 30 seconds. They bring the girl is babysitting the one Josh has a crush on, and she brings her over to her house, and I'm like, oh my god, that's that actress from Ozark. If this is her only role, like, to be this one line, like, I'm gonna feel so sad for her. And like, literally, that was in my mind and for like a week until I saw her in the next movie, and then I was like, okay, everything's great. But I like that the world was so connected like that.
I love that, and I love, and now we're obviously getting into spoilers and the other films, but I love how clearly, after you've seen all of them, the story is told and wrapped up, and there's this beautiful, not even through line, but like this full circle.
Yes.
And it all comes back together so well that, you know, you just want to rewatch them.
Yeah.
And
oh, I do. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I told you, after I watched 1978, I just wanted that feeling again, because I had watched it. And then the next night, it's like, I wanted that same feeling, because it has everything I love in it. It had the, like, of course, the camp and the nostalgic horror. And we haven't even gotten to the gore yet. And I love a good romance in my horror, and every one of them had romance in it, which I love. I love that. And so it just gave me like all the feels, and it was funny, and it was like unexpected, and it was a slasher, but it had that supernatural element that I love. So it was just like, oh my god, and witches.
I know.
Like, fuck. I mean, it's too much. I loved it.
I know. It's so great. Like, okay, so the first movie, I got a lot of Scream vibes, and I loved it. And of course, that was set in the 90s. I love the little touches, like, I mean, obviously everything comes back into play, but their mascot is the witches.
And yeah.
When like the catalyst for the whole event, when they're on the school bus and they're being reckless and they're going to throw out that ice and everything.
Yes.
It gave me like these really strong, like, horror feelings, like, okay, that's horrific in set in a realistic setting. Yet the reason it's so horrific is because we were all reckless teenagers. And I remember people being on the bus trying to open the emergency door and doing
stuff. Oh God.
Things, you know?
Yeah, no, that's that true stuff. It's like, yeah, sure, it's really scary that there's like demons coming up from the ground, but like the idea that they could like throw a cooler out the back of a bus, like, that is true. And it's scary. And we're moms, so yeah. We don't like that.
And then of course the 1978 had such Friday the 13th vibes. And then I read the article that said that Friday the 13th, Jason Lives, was filmed at that same camp.
I saw that. That's so cool. I know that there's like places where you can, I think where the original Friday the 13th is, like, for one night only, they have like something there. They should do it like a horror summer camp at that camp where Jason Lives.
So cool. Yeah.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
I love it. And oh my god, in the second one, well, and then of course the third one later, all the Stephen King references.
Yes.
So cute. Okay. And what a gut punch that love relationship was.
So, okay. And I love Gillian Jacobs, by the way. So I think it was really cool that she was Ziggy and everything. Okay. I thought he was so cute. See, here's the thing, you guys, like, he's talking about Stephen King, and I got romance too. I got
hard eyes.
So cute. And like, I would be all about it. And so then when I knew, like, okay, yeah, he's, I mean, you know, the whole time, but you know, he's going to be the sheriff. I'm like, okay, now let's reunite. Like, now in the third movie, let's get together. And then no, I saw some people be like, I knew it or whatever. I didn't know it. I was blinded by the Stephen King references. I thought he was a good guy.
I watched These All with Campbell, and there was one point and I said, oh no, I think that he's the bad guy because he seems too perfect in the third movie, like back in the past. And
yeah. Course,
you know, it's the same actor. And I'm like, oh no. And then it was, and it was just like,
oh, it is a gut punch. That's good storytelling. Cause you're just like, no, I love all the different murderers and how God,
so cool.
Like, that's such a great concept. They all come back and like the Ruby one sings and
oh my God,
there's that little kid in the mask. And
okay. So they referenced it before and Campbell's like, and so when we started 1666, he's like, we're going to find out who's plucking kids' eyeballs out. And I'm like, I didn't even remember that. And then of course when that happens, it was horrific.
That was one of the scariest parts, I think.
I think so.
That was really, when he walks in and all the kids are sitting in the pews like that. And then he like sees the eyeballs on the ground. Oh, and okay. So that gets in the gore. Everybody loved, I think, even people who didn't even like the first movie liked that kill, the grocery store kill. Yes.
Yeah.
That was great. And I thought the gore was just wonderfully done. Like there were so many great kills. Oh my gosh. And they didn't hold back. Like in 1978, like they were killing kids.
Yeah. Yeah. Like,
there was no,
yeah,
and shy about it.
Like all these children.
Yeah.
God.
Yes. Oh,
it was so good. I love the climax at the mall with like the glow in the dark.
Oh my God.
Stuff. Like that whole sequence. I'm just like, I mean, if I would have been in a theater, I feel like the audience would have been cheering along, you know?
Yeah.
It's just so well done, well paced, well plotted. Apparently, yeah. I mean, they say that this deviated from the books, or are these not based on books, or what's the,
they're not based on books. It's more like the setting is correct and, okay, and everything. But, as far as I know, I'm not a Fear Street expert. I literally haven't read them in 25 years, but, as far as I know, they're not actual like adaptations. It's more just like a, you know, feeling of what they're like, but I guess I'm surprised I saw so many negative thoughts about it. And part of me is like, well, I kind of want to know what the thinking is behind that. But then I'm also kind of like, no, that's okay. I don't need to know why you don't like it, because I like it. And I enjoyed it. I thought they were so fun. You know, they're just fun movies. They're, that being said, though, they made a concerted effort to be diverse. They made a concerted effort to, you know, talk about the haves and the have nots. So it's not like there wasn't any substance there.
No, it's true. There were feminist points. There were, like you said, diversity in couples and same sex couples and then casting, female driven. Yeah. Like it checked all the boxes and still managed to not be like preachy in a way that sometimes, you know, people complain about.
Yeah. No, I thought they were really fun. If I was like if I was a teenager, like, well, I would have just died to have something like that. I mean, 3 weeks of three fresh movies that are all connected together.
Give me a break. Like so we're living spoiled. The dream.
I know we are. And I'm definitely going to rewatch them all. I don't think I'm quite ready to show them to Dexter just because of the sex and stuff like that, but maybe I can hold my hand over his eyes for a few parts, but I think he would like some of them because he's really enjoying the Conjuring universe right now. And so I think he would appreciate like the universe of everything.
Right. Right. Oh, so good. Now, I don't want to rank them like, individually. I think we should just rank them as a trio, like on a scale of 0 to 10.
Yeah.
Zero being you hated it, 10 being you think it was a perfect trilogy. What's the scale?
Ooh.
The thing that just came to mind was eyeballs, but we can't do that. It's just too horrific.
Well, the thing that came to my mind was the part when her hand gets freaking cut off.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was...
Her hands.
Let's use Seraphir hands.
Yeah.
How many Seraphir, you know, torn off hands do you give?
I'm going to give it 9. I was giddy. I felt things. I liked the romance. I felt sad when Nick Good was evil. It was awesome when the, you know, he got killed. I liked all the characters, and even the ones I didn't necessarily like, I still wanted to watch them and see what happened with them. I loved how the story was all sort of moving together, yet you can watch each movie on its own if you wanted to. I loved it.
Yeah, I loved it too. I'm going to give it 9.5. And so that means like when her hand is half on and half off.
It's more when it's got a thread holding it still.
Yeah.
Or...
Yeah. Oh. And so I know I was just going to say that I'm not going to rank them, but let me just say that I enjoyed them more as they went along. And now I think when I go back and rewatch the first one, I'll appreciate it even more.
Yeah, I think so too. Because I think the first one, it's hard to like, there was a lot of information to give us, and there was a lot of setting up of that world that was maybe that's why that particular one is the least favorite, just because it had so much like info dump or something. But right. I freaking loved it. Yeah. I loved it all. I'm so glad they chose to make it rated R, like,
yes,
and make it for people who grew up reading the Fear Street books and now can appreciate, like, because they just did some really good gore. And I love the freaking thing down under the town that's like, here's a question though. I have a question. When they're like in under the toilets, there's no poop under there,
but apparently there was because it smelled like it. They just didn't
show they didn't show it, I guess, but I was like, where's the poop?
Oh, Meg. If you need to
see, this is poop. A consistency, and I don't mean consistency of poop. I mean, like, this is like, that was my only thing. Is like, wait, there's toilet paper, and they're talking about how it smells, but I feel like no one's gone to the bathroom in there.
I think that's taking it a step too far.
Okay, so that was, they can show those deaths, but they can't have real poop that they're climbing
that's,
up.
That's taking it too far.
Okay, fair.
It's like the thing, like for me, I don't need to see anything that resembles vomit coming out of someone's actual mouth. You can make the retching sound over a bucket, and I get it. Ugh. I don't need as you're like eating something. Yeah.
No,
but I don't need to see anything coming out of anybody's mouth. And I don't need to see real poop in or fake in an outhouse.
It's not that I want to see real poop. It's just confused me because I'm like, has this outhouse been closed? Like, I needed like the backstory.
This is the hill you're gonna die on, or the
outhouse. Yeah, this is, it's like, well, the movies would have been good, but they didn't do that.
I didn't mind all the music, but where's the poop? Oh, God.
Okay, fair.
Hey, maybe somebody listening can do a poop edit for me.
Yeah, I'll do a poop edit for me. Add all the poop in.
It's like the butthole edit of Cats, how they had to edit all the buttholes out. This is going to be the opposite for you. That there's poop put in the outhouse.
Because I felt it wasn't realistic in this world of witches and spells. I need poop.
That is the hill you're gonna die on.
In fact, just add it into like every movie.
Yeah,
that's what I say.
You know, I do have to say though, I think one of the most terrifying episodes of the X-Files for me is the host, specifically because of the outhouse stuff.
Yeah,
we had a cabin, and well, we still do, and it has an outhouse, and like, no, thank you.
No, I mean, no, I've talked about before about the Stephen King short story about him getting trapped in the bottom of an outhouse. And it's, but the thing is though, it's much better to write that than do a visual of it. So I get it. But I mean, that's terrifying.
Yeah. Yeah. It's July, everybody. And speaking of outhouses, if you are near one or you're having to use one this week in July, my God, it's so hot. It must smell so bad.
I know. Somebody was telling me that it's so hot at their house that they put tin foil on the windows. I didn't know that was that was a thing you did. It was so hot outside, they put tin foil on their window.
How, what does that reflect back so the heat doesn't come in?
I don't know. You tell me.
Oh, boy. This sounds like a conspiracy theory.
Well, you know, I think it's just, it's a testament to how hot it is and everyone's melting and global warming.
Everybody's trying to do what they can do.
Exactly.
If it's like a placebo effect, if they feel
exactly. Exactly.
Well, stay cool, friends. And we will be back next week with more things horror. Until next time, we'll see you in the horror section.
Bye.